DAX is the language of Power BI. It stands for Data Analysis Expressions, and it's a very rich, functional language, much like the Excel formula language that you might be used to. For this lab, we've got a guest speaker, a guy called Alberto Ferrari. He's one of the world's top gurus on DAX. He'll give you an overview of the language and dive into some of the functions and the functionality that you need to know. In this first set of segments, he'll give you an introduction and cover some of the key data types in the DAX language.
Let's start speaking about DAX. DAX is the language of Power Pivot, of analysis services, of Power BI, all the tools that implement the analysis services stack inside it. The best definition that I ever heard about DAX was given from a student a few years ago in Ireland. At the end of my course, I asked them, now what you think about DAX? And he answered, DAX is simple, but it's not easy. The concepts of DAX are simple. The ideas, the code, everything is straightforward. That said, don't expect DAX to be an easy language. Said in other words, if you are totally new for DAX, don't expect to learn DAX in 4 hours. That is simply impossible. What I expect to teach you in these 4 hours are where are the hard parts where you will need to spend time studying. So to the new buyers, I hope to set a good background so you have an idea about what DAX is and to understand where you will need to study more. For the ones of you who already know DAX, well, my hope is just to give you a more solid, a more sound background about what evaluation contexts are and what is the right way of writing DAX code. This is a typical expression in DAX. There is no need for you to understand what it does right now, but it's just to show you that DAX is a functional language. Functional language means it's like the Excel formula language. Also, Excel has a functional language, meaning that the full execution of code is just a single function code. Function call. In that case, you see there is a sum x, which is the first function call, and then sum x has a parameter, two parameters. Sum x has, that formula is wrong, sum x of a filter. Filter, it contains an error, that's totally stupid. It filters the values of the date year, and then for each date year, it checks if the date year is greater than 2000, then it computes the value, otherwise the value multiplied by 90. But the point is not understanding the formula, it's more looking at how it looks. It's just a single function call, and then the parameters of the function call define the logic of the behavior. The execution in DAX starts from the innermost. So you go to the innermost parameter, and that is the first part that is executed. Then its result is used by outer function until they reach the first one. The second point why this formula is important is because people coming from Excel typically write all their formulas into a single line. So everything is written in a single line, a text box that is nearly impossible to read. And they tend to do the same with DAX. It turns into a nightmare. It's nearly impossible to read a DAX expression if it is not properly formatted. And formatting is pretty simple. You just write the function name and then all the parameters indented inside it. Otherwise, if you don't follow some formatting rules, using DAX is nearly impossible. Now, DAX is a programming language, and all the programming languages have some data types. DAX is strongly typed. If you are coming from Excel, you probably are not used to that idea of defining a data type for every column, because in Excel, you typically have your worksheet, and on that, you put values into cells. Every cell can contain whatever you want. DAX does not work this way. DAX is based on tables. Tables is divided into columns, and each column has a strong data type. The data type can be a number or any other data type. Basically, there are only two important data types, which are numbers and everything else. Numbers are integer, decimal, currency, daytime, and Boolean values. They call them true, false values. I'm used to call them Boolean. And these are all considered numbers. Other data types like strings or pictures, or binary objects, whatever kind of data type you might have, these are other data types. The difference is somewhat important because there are functions that work only on numbers and there are functions that work on any data type. If a function works on any number, then it works on any of the first set of data types. So you can, for example, take the sum of a boolean. Doesn't make much sense, but you can do that if you want. Whereas, of course, you cannot take the sum of a string. Since the people that created DAX, they basically took the Excel formula language and the SQL language and MDX, they shaked everything together, and then DAX came out from the recipe. There are functions that work only on numbers just because they wanted all the functions to be compatible with Excel. So if you are familiar with Excel, you will be in a very cozy environment because it basically has the same set of functions and the same behavior. What does operator overloading mean? It's meaning that even if DAX is strongly typed, you can write complex expressions mixing data types at your will. And conversion happens when needed. So you can have two columns, one column containing a data, one column containing a string. And if you want to sum them, DAX permits you to do that. It tries to do conversion in an automatic way. So for example, you can take 5 and 4 that are strings. You see they are enclosed in double quotes. But because you use the plus operator, plus transforms the two strings into numbers and returns you a number as a result. So the sum of two strings is legally a number, whereas the ampersand, which is the string concatenator, concatenates two strings, and you can pass to it two different numbers. They are converted to strings, and then concatenation happens. The idea of Microsoft is that conversion happens when needed, and you don't need to worry about the data types of your columns. This might be useful in the case where you don't know the data type of the columns in the data model you are working with. Now, I have nothing against people that don't know the data type of columns of their data model, but if you are not used to data types and if you are not used to know your data model, then there are a lot of jobs which are interesting, but doing data analysis and working with the data models is probably not the best for you. What you should do is know your data model, know exactly the data type of each column, and never, ever trust automatic conversion. If some kind of conversion needs to happen, you know it, and you do, and you handle it by yourself. Don't trust the engine, because that means you are introducing errors in your code that might happen because of conversion failing. And errors will be your worst enemy, especially speaking about performance. The presence of errors in your code is going to kill the performance of any DAX measure. So you basically don't want them to happen. So I had to show the slide. And now that you know the behavior, you can forget about it and never use it in your life. Among the many data types, there is one which is worth a bit more attention, which is the datetime. Datetime are handled in DAX, I think, the same way they are handled in Excel. I'm not an expert at Excel at all. So datetime are stored as a floating point. It's just a number that contains an integer part and then a decimal part. The integer part is the number of days after the 30 of December 1899. The slide is right. It's not the 31 of December, it's the 30 of December. So 1 means the 31 of December of the previous century. I honestly have no idea why the team decided to use 0 for the 30 of December, but that's it. Whereas the decimal part is the fraction of a day. So if you want to represent 12 hours, you divide 1 by 2, you write 0.5, that is 12 hours in the DAX language. And you can trust this behavior. So you can basically create a calculated column that sums and subtracts numbers from dates, and that is going to work in a straightforward way. If you want to remove the fractional part of a date, then you simply remove the decimal part from a number, and as a result, you get the date without the time. Keep in mind that, again, speaking about date times, any calculation on date, like some subtraction or summing dates, is expected to work after the 1st of March of 1900, so of the previous century. Any calculation that happens before might lead to errors and mistakes.